All right, guys, welcome to Wide Awake News Radio. I'm your host, Charlie McGrath. It is election day, selection day, and we're going to get into that. Me and Eric Lovely, hour number one. We have Sherry Edwards coming on to give us some voice analysis of some of these politicians and some foreign politicians as well in hour number two. Couple of announcements I want to make. You know, for those of you listening and not in the chat, please go to wideawakenews.com, click on the Wide Awake Radio button. That'll take you into the chat room, and you can join the folks in there. Hopefully very soon I'll start to be able to record promotional videos for the program. I know that I've received some messages about that I used to do that, and I don't do it anymore, and it's a time issue more than anything else. Plus, we have Karen updating the schedule every day, which is available at the website, so I figured if I had to cut some time somewhere, I was going to be on that. But things are starting to come in line now that I'll be able to do that again. We're live on Justin TV. We're live on Rinse Radio. We are rebroadcast on YouTube. We're rebroadcast on Justin TV. And now we were being rebroadcast the following day on Oracle, Doug Owens' network over there, a blacklisted news. Oracle Network was rebroadcasting, but now their broadcasting is live nightly, Monday through Friday. So I want to welcome all the Oracle listeners to the live broadcast. And I appreciate your guys' support. And Doug gave me some of the numbers. There's quite a few of you guys hanging out and listening to the program from Oracle. So welcome and thank you for your support. And we hope that we can bring you information that that is helpful. All right. I do want to get into it right away with Eric because him and I traded some ideas during the day a little bit. If you were listening on Justin TV, you heard us talking about gun selections. And maybe before the end of the day or before the end of this first hour, we'll be able to get into some of our favorite self-defense weaponry. But to start off with, I want to talk a little bit, obviously, about the selection. And I talked to Eric on between me getting off my day job and heading to my night job. And I said, and the guys who have listened to me every night talk about this election on the nights that we've spoke to it, you know, I probably sound like a broken record at this point, but it has been really, really obvious since the convention, the time of the convention, when we were trying to eliminate any competition to the GOP, trying to make sure that people like Ron Paul never had a voice. And it was clear, crystal clear, that Mitt Romney was going to be the guy. We saw all the effort from the mainstream, from the so-called conservative media, pile on the Romney bandwagon. Then we saw the left gear up to pile on the Obama bandwagon. And look, it's simple. I mean, this thing is going to be very, very close. I still think Obama's going to pull it out. I've been saying that since the convention and for no other reason other than we have a nation that right now has over 50% of the people that receive one form of check or another, some form of assistance or another from the government. And that's just... You know, and I'm not even talking the morality of that. I'm not even speaking to the morality of it because I truly believe the people of this country deserve the money that's being borrowed in our name far more than where most of this money is going, which is the corporate special interest. But you create a lot of votes when you are doling out that kind of money. And for no other reason than there's over half the country that is dependent on government at this point. In one form or another, not 100%, but in one form or another, in order to put food on the table or to keep the lights on, you know, that is a very, very – that's been my main reason that I think we're going to stay the course, as it were, with Obama. Time will tell. I mean, it's early. Polls are just now starting to close, but time will tell. Fabian for Liberty just sent me a text saying it looks like Obama is going to pull this out. And, you know, and honestly, in the last hour, I haven't checked anything. The last thing I checked was Drudge, and it had 190 to 191. It wouldn't surprise me at all, not one bit, to see this thing go into not just tomorrow, but, you know, weeks and go into this battle like we've seen in recent years. And to that point, I was speaking with Eric about this tonight, that, and I want to get your take on this, Eric, because you've had about an hour or so to digest my thought process here. It really seems that over the last decade, we have been shown not I'll say covertly, not very not in our face, but we've been given one example of after another of how representative government fails the people. Now, before anybody gets that mixed up, I'm not calling for a dictatorship. I'm saying that beneath the current, we've been delivered this steady message over and over again that representative government is a failure from start to finish, and we can't fix our own problems. We're not smart enough. We just can't get along, and that's why the government in general is failing. And we can, we can go back to George W. Bush when he ran against Al Gore, and this split election, this hanging Chad going to the Supreme Court. Nobody knew. A lot of people think Bush lost. A lot of people think Gore won. A lot of people think Kerry won in 2004. So we're seeing this assault on our election process. But it's either an outright assault so we can drive this wedge of division even deeper and pit one side of this country against another, or it is just the times that we live in has brought us this massive division between the perceived left and the perceived right. The end result is we have a nation that is completely fractured, and it's fractured, we're being given the reason, because of our political system, because of this deep division. Now, you take that deep division and this this example of how representative government is a failure, and I'm not saying outright that it's a failure, but I'm saying it's an example. If you stood back and looked at the last decade, you would say, look, this presidential election, oh, man, it was stolen. The next one was stolen. The next one, we're in the middle of a financial crisis. Obama gets in. This one, whoever comes out the victor tonight, the other side is going to say stole the election. And we already hear the talk. We already hear the voting machines are flipping votes. We hear, people talking about if the Democrats lose, it's because they stole it. Or if the Republicans lose, it's because the Democrats stole it. Black Panther's here. We have people mad there. It is, the controversy has already begun when the polls are just now starting to close. But we can expand that a little bit, Eric. And let me stop right there, because I want to get, we got 2 minutes before the first break. I want to get your thought on this staged election. It seems staged. It seems just for public consumption. But over the last decade, our political system has shown us overtly or covertly that our political system's broken. And I believe it's part and parcel with the message of we have to give up more freedom and liberty to fewer people because we just can't take care of ourselves.
Well, this has been a mantra that's been going on for a long time. People wonder why the states no longer pick their own senators, as the Constitution said that it was the way that it should be. The Electoral College does not function as the Constitution dictated that it should be. This is nothing new. It's just a further progression of moving you further and further away from representative government. And, what it really boils down to me, Charlie, and I've chewed on it for a while, and it's unfortunate that I come up with the same answer. It's not a sign of failed representative government. It's a sign of a failed society, because it is different if they wait till you're not home, bust in your window, sneak in your house, take all your stuff, and disappear before you get back. This is society's fault. These individuals show up, knock on your front door, then walk in, tell you you're going to give them everything. They're going to take it all from you. They own everything. You own nothing. And you're going to sit on the couch and shut up and like it. So because you've let them do this, it is your failure. It is all of our failure. It is the failure of the individuals. And, a lot of portion goes into a video that you talked about last night, but it was something I was definitely wanting to talk about today, too, that really is an impact. And hopefully we'll get into the little lady who got evicted off of her property and how that took place. Yeah. But this is what you're looking at. It's disgusting. We stand around and we scream and we cry thinking that someone is going to fix it for us, that somehow we're going to vote. People are talking about it's your duty. You got to get out there and you got to play the red team, blue team, or if you don't do that, vote third party. Why are you voting at all? I mean, voting in it legitimizes a corporate organization. There's so many things to talk about when you're talking about this particular thing known as voting and moving away from a representative republic.
Yeah, no doubt about it. And we're going to get into more of that on the backside of this break. We also have Richard from Washington on hold. Richard, we're going to go to you as well. We're going to be back with Eric of the Lovely Family and more Wide Awake News Family, and more Wide Awake News Radio in just a few minutes. Hang tight. Everybody wants to rule the world. That's what I'm hearing.
Not me.
So
can you hear it, dear?
We are still live on JTV.
Yes, your audio is still live on JTV.
Are we running? We're running video on JTV too, as well, right? For me, anyway.
Yes, video is posting out to JTV.
Okay, I just saw your icon is the live Monday through Friday thing, and I didn't know if you were sending me back the feed again, like you were last night or whatever. Never mind. I'll shut up.
I'm going to take a look at that. The feedback system might be sending you an erroneous image.
Yeah, it's June 11th, 2012, 809. No, you're doing it. You're doing it European style.
You're doing. All right, I'm getting ready to turn on my camera. I'm getting out the green Jello.
What? What was that? You're freaking me out. What'd you say?
Don't you read up there before, as he was, well, it was part of the conversation, and he said 8 minutes. Somebody said something about the time was left. Going to the bathroom or whatnot. Yeah.
Oh, okay. All right. I got it.
And I said, perfect. Just enough time to rub some green Jello on my naked body.
Now everybody on JTV knows that.
Oh, but it's funny.
It is funny.
You know, I mean, it really, I don't know. I've taken a lot of flack. Going to talk about John Knox a little bit.
Well, I didn't mean to dominate that entire first segment. So I'll turn it to you, buddy.
I don't understand a word you just said.
Really?
Well, yeah, because my bandwidth is low, and he feeds the video looped back in. And the audio that I receive is kind of gurgly. My wife listens to it; sounds great. It's just.
I do apologize.
All right, you should be getting proper feed of what's going out to JTV at this point.
Very good. Me and Eric, can you hear me okay?
Yeah, I hear you perfect.
So far, I've got good audio on Eric. So if the bandwidth issue must only be going in the other direction.
All right.
Yeah, my down, well, my up speed is only 0.27, 0.34, something like that.
Well, you know, Eric, when you got two tin cups and a string for an internet connection, you got to keep the string dry.
I can't help it, man. It's hard to do up here in these higher reaches.
Up in the boondocks. Have you? I hope to get into this a little bit, Eric. Can you see this?
No, your video froze on me.
I'm sending a please stand by image to the video. Charlie, if you want me to send your your live video is
froze. All right, welcome back to Wide Awake News Radio. I'm Charlie McGrath, your host. Eric Lovely is co-hosting tonight. I'm going to continue. I'm going to turn it back over to Eric because he was making a point about the voting thing. And we do have Richard from Washington. So hang on, Richard. We'll get you on in this segment for sure. Eric Lovely, please continue.
Okay, I didn't understand a single solitary word that just came out of your mouth.
Well... let me try it again. I said we ended the first segment with you talking about the futility of voting in this system, and I wanted to kick it back over to you, but we did have Richard from Washington on the phone as well, and we'll get to you, Richard, in this segment. Was that better?
Yeah, I'm fine. We can take Richard real quick, and I can talk about the other right after. I don't want to leave callers hanging like we've done before.
Okay. Richard, welcome to the program.
Hey, good afternoon or good evening, depending on where you are. I just came into the house and turned you on, as I usually do if you're not on. And I just got back from the store, and I'm going to give an example that seems a little, you know, strange from what you're talking about, but it fits right in. I went to a store earlier today, and it was a typical deli store, and they had three sizes of containers on the top of the thing. So I pointed to the large one and said I'd like a pound and a half of potato salad. No problem. I went to the store this afternoon, or when I just got back now, and I did the same thing, pointed to the pound and a half, or the bigger container, the two-pound container, and said I'd like a pound and a half. The young lady filled a one-pound container and then started to fill a half-pound container to give me the two containers for the pound and a half. And I was a little upset at that, and I couldn't understand why. But then the two people from the deli bar came to find out what the problem was. And they said it was a store policy to do the two-container thing. So then I called back to the store after I got to thinking about it. I said, so what you're telling me is you're training people to abuse the resources of you know, whatever. And she said, no, that's not the policy. So she directly contradicted herself. And why I bring this up is this is exactly what happens in the voting. It seems like what we are told is, if let's say the issue was, is it all right to kill every one of your family members on Thursday? It'd be 49-51, and you wouldn't find out till the end of the voting what the decision was. It seems like this is the way they're getting us to be completely dumbed down, because we're not supposed to have common sense, and we're not supposed to exert any, you know, common thinking, or you know, we're not to intervene in the situation if you see a discrepancy as to what's happening, because everybody's going to justify subjectively what's happening. And I'll let it go at that.
No, that's a great point. I mean, you know, it is all about conform. And you know, what you also bring up there is the tyranny of the majority, even if it's 51-49. And you're exactly right. I mean, we're not even asking or looking at the right questions. We don't have, you know, again, a nation of 310 million people, then we always whittle it down to these handful to choose from. And then we have, you know, a bought out media that is in control. And then this process, debate process, where the questions are canned, they're staged, the whole the event is staged, and real issues that truly affect the country are left by the wayside. And most people are taught they're just not that important. We need to care more about gay marriage and whatever other social issues that are brought to the forefront, rather than big, meaty, nation-defining issues such as expanding our military dominance around the world or our monetary policy. These are things that we're taught are not worth the time of day, and because of that, we latch on to the red or blue mantra.
Atwell about the Roman Caesar or Caesar's Messiah, I forget exactly what the title was, and the same thing was happening back then, and what the whole trend was to do was to bring us back into a feudal system, and it looks like that's exactly what the trend is now. We're supposed to just succumb and go back to a feudal system where there's going to be the mega elite and us, you know, slave or followers, and we have no really say in the whole operation.
Absolutely, 100% correct. And this isn't Eric. Are you still with us?
Oh yeah, I'm here.
Okay, get in here because I thought I lost you. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Well, no, I mean it's definitely true. I mean that's the way you look at it. The only difference about today's fiefdom society, and if you don't know what a fiefdom is, if you need a little education on it, you know, feel free to look into it. Fiefdoms were like small versions of a state owned by a lord or given governance to a lord by a king or something of that nature. The only thing that's changing now is instead of calling themselves king, they're calling themselves highly educated technocrat, that they simply know better than you. It's the exact same system as kings and queens and lords and fiefdoms.
That's right.
Exact same. The only thing they've done is they've taken a crown off their head and putting a piece of white paper in a picture frame and hung it behind them on the wall. That's the only difference. The crown has gone from their head to hanging on the wall. You know, I'm smarter than you. I know more than you. I'm better than you. So you just take what I give you. And, you know, this is something that the elites have disgustingly fawned over and drooled after and desired and coveted. They hated the idea of freedom. But that's a whole, I mean, that's 5 hours worth of history lesson. five different programs probably that we could go into talking about. And the elites wrote it down on paper. They told people, you know, as the government was forming, as America was creating the Constitution, they told them that one day they would bring back their way of life, and that the people, they would show the world that the people would fail because they couldn't govern themselves, because they weren't smart enough, they weren't good enough, that only divine right. Well, now divine right has changed into college education.
Yeah, and there's plenty of examples we can get into after that. Richard, you're more than welcome to hang out. We're going to take our second break. We're going to be back with Eric Lovely for Wide Awake News Radio. We'll be back in just a few minutes, guys. Hang tight, please.
All I wish is to be alone. Stay away. Don't you invade my home. Best out if you hang outside. Don't come in. I'll only run and hide. Who can it be now? Who can it be?
Charlie McGrath of WideAwakeNews.com here with a message about Legacy Premium freeze-dried storable food. Available at buyemergencyfoods.com. I recently returned from a trip to the manufacturing facility, and I'm here to tell you it was impressive. Over 50 employees working hard to produce the highest quality, best tasting, most healthy, GMO-free, freeze-dried storable food on the market.
I'll tell you.
And now that I've been to the manufacturing facility, I can tell you from receiving to...
Whiffy bitch on the butt again, huh?
Yeah, well, you know... You taught me that I can't use the Wi-Fi because it interrupts with the same internet signal.
Now your audio is a little flaky. Or did I
connected back to the... Hold on. It might have connected me back to the video output here. Hold on. One. No, it should be good, buddy. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Oh, this... right now the audio sucks.
Wonder why.
I'm not sure. We might have just got a stale Skype connection. I'm going to go ahead and disconnect from both of you and reconnect.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Sorry about that, guys.
All right. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten.
All righty. You're sounding a little bit better. Do that again. Give me a five count.
One, two, three, four, five.
You know, your audio is scratchy, and I'm not sure why.
Yeah, let me see. Is there anything goofy going on here?
My wife wants to know if you got that stuff fixed.
One, two, three, four, five.
That may just be as good as it's going to get, Charlie. I'm not sure what happened, but I was sure that I was getting better audio than that from you earlier.
Let's see if I got anything. Let me try this. One, two, three, four, five.
That sounds a little bit better.
One, two, three, four, five.
It's still got a little scratchy to it, but, you know, it may just be as good as we're going to get. You know, I don't think we...
What if I get really, really close like this?
Yeah, that's what we need. Yeah,
is that
right.
Bad? Is that really loud?
No, that would probably not be a good idea. That's almost as bad as Eric's green Jell-O.
One, two, three, four, five.
Yeah, now you're at the bottom of a well.
Okay, all right. Well, let's not do the well. Hi, I'm not at the bottom of the well, and I'd like you to... Join me not at the bottom of the well.
I think that's as good as we're going to get, Charlie. It's not perfect, but it's just going to have to be good enough.
I wonder if I'm crossed over here. Hold on.
You know, one thing.
Gary Hendershot. Guys, welcome back to Wide Awake News Radio. I'm Charlie McGrath, your host. Eric Lovely, neo-feudal system, continue.
Well then, you know, basically, people aren't really grasping what the idea of indentured servitude was, how it was formed, what debt-based society really means. they don't grasp how the Council of Governors is chopping territory off and sending it and selling it to basically banking institutions and corporations, setting up block fiefdoms or smaller microstates within states, which I will also point out is against the law. And we could really spend hours talking about a feudal system, but basically what you will do is you'll be allowed to stay on the land wherever they designate that land, and you'll work, and you will be allowed what's called a suffering. And a suffering means that you'll be allowed to keep 10, maybe 15% of your production, just enough to keep you going, just enough to keep you in the fight, and the rest of it is property of the king. The rest of it is property of whoever is in charge of that fiefdom to directly take the labor. Now, the reason why this is a technocrat version, because instead of doing it the way that they used to do it with soldiers and swords, well, they still do that. We'll get into that too. But instead of doing the things where the tax collector would come around once a month and beat on the door with a skull to intimidate you so that when you open the door, you know, he's got a skull in one hand, he's got a bunch of soldiers behind him and a bag for his tax money. You know, these are things that are going away because now they just do it through the banking system. They literally just tax directly from the monetary source, and you foot the bill through loss of prosperity or purchasing power and so forth. And a lot of people ask me questions about this, and it's a real simple analogy. And I honestly can't remember where I was first exposed to it, but I've kind of honed it a little bit. But it's really simple. Imagine you got a big giant glass box with no top on it, okay? And if you take bobbers, which are floating devices for fishing, and you throw them in the tank, and as you pour water in, the bobbers will rise up off the bottom and float on top of the actual water, okay? And you will have you could actually measure up the side of the glass, seeing how they've risen depending on how much water you put in, okay? Well, here's the idea. The bobber is goods. Either a productive service, an instrument that actually creates wealth of some kind. The water is currency. People don't understand that the more you fill, just like the bobbers will continue to rise. Now, you have to also understand this also explains the markets. As prices go up and down and up and down, that's them pouring the money in. It's called velocity, which causes a wake across the economy, which causes prices to go up and down and up and down and up and down until it stabilizes with the new level of currency that has been injected or the new level of water. It's never going to go down until you either blow a hole in the side and that's a deflationary spiral or other different things. But this is a really easy analogy for people to understand. And they're continuing to dump the water in and they're continuing to dump the money in. And the debt for the labor to produce the water is all fostered upon you. It's never printed. It's not in existence. So, I mean, the whole entire idea of the fiefdom system and voting is ridiculous. It's insanity. Yeah. And everybody
– and it's like Richard said. Sorry. It's like Richard said. Richard, you're still on with this, aren't you? Okay. I think we let Richard go. Richard, I apologize. I thought you were hanging out over the break, and I should have went to you right after the break. But it's like Richard said. We're being led down this path of focusing on what's not important, and then you know it's almost you're a misfit if you think for yourself or if you think with you know if you use common sense to see where we are. But you're okay if you just join the herd and march right along into you know this new monarchy system that we're going into, Eric.
Absolutely. Check your sound real quick, by the way. And while we're looking at this, people really need to understand that this is this is where you're going. The tax man still shows up, and you know, to me, it absolutely disgusts me. You know, I watched a video, and I just couldn't believe it. And then I saw Charlie's video. It's posted on the right-hand side of Wide Awake News on the front page. If you guys get a chance to see it, and in that video, he will provide a link. You see, I'm not going to provide the link for you. I told you exactly where to go, and that will generate traffic and do all that good stuff, you know. But when you guys go there, I want you to watch the link that's attached about the little lady who gets evicted. Now, you look at these soldiers. These are soldiers. Charlie can tell you just by looking at them, as well as other servicemen. I mean, these police officers, where did you think you were looking at? Afghanistan?
I thought I was looking at Afghanistan. I hope my audio is better now. But I thought I was looking at Afghanistan or I was looking at Iraq. I mean, you know, it was a mountainous terrain. So my first thought was, oh, we got some troops in Afghanistan doing their business.
So, I mean, to me, you know, ladies and gentlemen, a lot of people, they don't want to go this far. And, you know, the station and Charlie and everybody is unassociated with these because this is my own opinion. But in my own opinion, in that situation, it was time to split skulls. The idea of what I saw on that video.
I watched it three times because I thought after I got the premise of it, I'm like, wait a minute, this has got to be fake. This cannot be happening right outside of Denver, right? This can't be happening to some lady who is behind on her mortgage payment that she's going to have stormtroopers, terrorists, root her out of her home. I couldn't believe it.
And, man, I couldn't either. And the whole disgusting thing, and that one piece of crap cop who's wandering around talking about, oh, I'm a good guy. You're not a good guy. Look, you people wearing badges who are taking part in these processes or who are allowing your fellow badge-toting scumbags to do this, you're guilty. You're disgusting. You're degenerates. There is no other way. Let me tell you, real men, I mean, even if it would have cost me my life in that situation, the sheriff, he'd have been the first one to take the first round. Now, that's my personal opinion, and people may not want to talk about violence, but he'd have took the first round that day. A 60, 70-some-year-old woman being booted out of her house. I actually think she's in her late 50s to early 60s, but she's not ready for retirement. She's on a fixed income. She can't, you know, and you're doing this in favor of the banks. There is massive amounts of adjudication on this particular case that the police know about, and they don't care. They know that it's being challenged all over the place, and they don't care.
Yeah, they're
this
just doing
is
their
Gestapo.
Job.
You know what I mean? I'm just doing my job. I'm just doing my job. Somebody's got to keep the peace. You can hear all this crap being said by these
all the excuses people are going to say. All the excuses people are going to say right up until they lose their job, because that's really what it boils down to. If you're getting a paycheck, you're always going to find people that are willing to you know, do whatever the bidding of the master is. Eric, I want to get to Meat Dog because he's on the line, and I know he's been holding for a minute. So, Meat, what's your question or your comment, sir?
Yeah, no, this is a fascinating topic, and I'm a fan of dystopic movies, and I guess I'm a glutton for punishment. I've seen them all from Soylent Green to Mad Max to the recent lugubrious The Road, and I see all kinds of possible scenarios for the future of this country. But let's just say, for the sake of argument, because, you know, there are several ways that I think this could pan out, but let's just say, for the sake of argument, that we do go into a form of a global, of neo-serfdom, you know, form of global, you know, where global fascism, and let's try to connect the dots of the things that we see that are either in place or rapidly being put into place now, with Agenda 21, with the compact cities, with the FEMA regions splitting up this country, and the Board of Governors ruling as oligarchs, and then the public-private partnerships usurping the role of federal, state, and local governments. And I see all these things converging together to basically diminish or totally eviscerate any what little bit of freedom that we have left, where it's a rollerball type of situation. What do you gentlemen think about that?
Hold on a sec. Hold on one sec. We're gonna do this break 3 minutes. We're gonna go right to you when we get back on the backside of this break. Guys, hang tight.
Okay, Charlie, the cables on your end, are you sure you might not have a cable that's been jerked on a little bit, might be slightly damaged?
Well, let me shut up, Eric.
If I was a betting man, I'd say that, you know, the cat chewed on your cable.
Well, I don't have
on your cable, Charlie.
Too much cable tugging. Is that better? Is that still
that now? See, that sorted it out. Yeah, so that's what leads me to believe it might be the cable. It seems like every time you
remember the funky connections that we have to go from the directional mic into my.
Well, it seems like every time you jiggle on the cable, you know, it sorts itself out for a little bit, and then you move the cable again, and I start getting really scratchy audio from you.
All right, so is it good right now?
Right now, it sounds good.
Well, I'm not going to move it then.
Get some damn duct tape and tape that wire down.
It's got a 20-foot cable on it. I've got it all duct taped together, so it's only about 3 feet long. But I've got an adapter.
I bet he bought Chinese duct tape. What do you think, Eric?
I think with his XD.
Yeah, he's got that, you know, old-fashioned non-sticking tape that come from China. He got a real good deal on it, though, I'm sure.
This is America. This is America, where every duct tape is made in China.
Got to get some of that Gorilla tape. That stuff's pretty good. It's better than duct tape.
Brett's reminding me that the callers, that the station pays by the minute for them holding on the line on the internet. So we're going to go right to meat. It's all about money, isn't it?
Yeah, pretty much. I don't know, man. I spoke my piece about that old lady video.
Yeah.
That's how I feel.
I thought it was fake.
Disgusting.
I wasn't even going to reference it, Eric, because I thought it was fake. I had to watch it 3 times before I thought, nope, this is real. This really happened.
Yeah. But, hey, what did they say? Can't happen here.
Oh, I heard the missus in the back. Is she okay?
Oh, yeah. Just a little throat clearing. Charlie says hi. She waved.
I heard her. She said hi. I heard her and saw her.
She's live on JTV.
I can't hear it. Keeps going in and out, so shut
off. I think is it your guys' string and cup method?
Yeah, I think that there's just not enough bandwidth, you know. Which whenever I was doing the show myself, she could just sit and listen to me, but she'd miss out on callers and whatnot. But she can't. She thinks that we're the dynamic duo, so she likes to listen so she can hear your side of the conversation. But we can't do that anymore. It seems. Having a little too much bandwidth issue.
Let's get you some more, can we?
Nope.
Weren't they trying to fix that problem down there, Eric?
Well, now the problems are fixed. I just have a lack of bandwidth. I mean, 1.5 megabits is the fastest you can get here, unless you're going to pay hundreds of dollars a month, you know, to get satellite internet. Understand the voice within.
Yeah. All right. Welcome back to Wide Awake News Radio. We're going to continue with Meat Dog, who's making some great points, talking about watching all kinds of movie genres such as Mad Max and Rollerblade, and you know what scenarios are going to play out. So, Meat, please continue.
Well, yeah, I'm just trying to just stick to this one scenario where we are basically devolve into a form of neo-serfdom, where corporations and public-private partnerships usurp all of our freedom and all of our sovereignty, and we are herded into compact Agenda 21 villages, and you have the FEMA regions, you have the Council of Governors that will basically act, that will lord over us, and then, of course, we can't forget, I think it was called the Committee of 12 with the President adding, making it 13, that will make the decisions in our budget that will determine the austerity measures that are going to be coming down the pike. I haven't heard anybody talk about that for at least 6 months.
Right, right. No, this is exactly what I mean when we've been shown this example of how representative government has failed. You know, our election process is flawed. It's rigged. It's fake. It's phony. It's we cheat and steal and all this. All this angst is created on both sides, and we've seen it for a decade now. And then we've seen government, and I didn't get into this. I cut to Eric in the first segment, but that was my second point, was when it comes to the effectiveness of government, it has been proven to us, and I think by design, it has been proven to be one crisis event after another is the only way things get done. So we have a crisis debt ceiling vote. The government's going to shut down. The world's going to come to an end. Oh, we're going to jack up the debt ceiling. We do that multiple times. We see everything from the collapse of 2008 to forward. nothing has been done unless it has been done on the verge of crisis. So we get this body of 12, this super Congress, they call it, plus the president. And, you know, they're coming together bipartisan. They're going to come up with a deal to reduce our deficit and reduce our spending and get us on a fiscally sane course. And lo and behold, 12 people can't get it done. So what is it teaching us? 535? That's too many people, too many representatives to get anything done. 12 people? That's too many to get anything done. Well, thank God Almighty, you know, we have the Federal Reserve sitting there ready to come in and save the day with the new Chicago plan, as the IMF put out the other day. So they could come out and say, look, all we have to do is get rid of all these hangups in free market capitalism and things will run better. But it is teaching the people, just like Richard, when he went in to get, you know, get something at a store and they won't load it in a common sense manner. You know, it's teaching the people that the representative government, it's not common sense to believe that that will actually work. It's teaching us exactly the opposite. We need a ruler from on high. Meet Eric.
Well, you know, actually, we really need to take this to the next level and start talking about, you know, people always, they're talking about, oh, the government, it's not a conspiracy. It's not, the government isn't working in this direction on purpose. You know, they're not doing that. Well, here, let me give you a news flash, ladies and gentlemen. All the stuff that Charlie and Meat have been talking about, it's old news. It's nothing. It's dirt under your foot. It is useless, because if you go right now and you look at the NDAA 2013 and look at the 37 amendments that has been added to the legislation, increasing the power across the board, look at how now they're creating a council. See, as I told you guys before, that Congress would be liquidated and non-existent. So now Congress, the Committee of 12, is going to report to the Board of Governors, and the Board of Governors will have every governor on it and the president, and they're going to make the new rules. Okay, this is the exact same thing as a fiefdom. What do you have? King on the hill. Who runs his little fiefdoms? His lords, I mean governors. This is the structure that's coming. It is being streamlined so that a bunch of little dictators will be directly under a big dictator, and that's how decisions will be made.
No doubt about it. No doubt about it. Meat, did you have anything else you wanted to add?
Yeah, it'll be the feudal equivalent of barons.
Yeah.
Basically, is what that'll be. And I live in Germantown, Maryland, here outside of D.C., and I've noticed that the police are continually pulling over commercial vehicles. And I talked to this one driver, and he said, yeah, they're like going over our vehicles with a fine-tooth comb, trying to find the slightest little thing that he can gig us on to find us. So, I don't know. I mean, I don't know how – hopefully this won't happen the way that we're – I hope this is a – you know, this is just a fantasy – that won't come, a nightmare that won't come true. I just don't know.
Yeah, well, I understand.
Thank you, gentlemen.
You bet. Thanks, Meat. I appreciate the call.
Absolutely. It was a great call. But, you know, and let me speak. The reality is it's boiling down where, you know, the ultimate answer of whether or not this is going to happen to us is whether or not we're going to resist. You know, I can tell you right now, I'm never going to see those fiefdoms come into where I live, because I'll be dead and gone. You know, I will not live in that kind of environment. I will not accept that kind of thing. And, you know, if that means getting all shot up, well, you know, I died free, ladies and gentlemen. You know, I don't have to suffer. Suffer means you surrendered. That's really what it means. It means that you threw in the towel and you gave up. And, you know, all of this can be changed and rearranged, but it's, look at that video with those sheriff's officers and the way they are in the street. Look, you are not going to beat that with a voting box. It's not going to happen. You aren't going to vote yourself out of this situation. If you could, it would have already been done. But you can't vote yourself out. This is going to take something completely different. All the free thinkers that are surround Charlie and that me and Charlie talk to, and, you know, Charlie himself, and we talk about these things, it's a society-changing event. The Mayans were right. The world is going to change this year into next year like you've never seen it before.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
It's not the end of mankind. And you know what? It can go one of two ways. It can change in a very beautiful way, in a very liberty-breathing, liberty-expanding way, or it can change into the absolute disgustingness of the Georgia Guidestones. Which one do you want? Which one do you want to live in? The video by John Quaid, if nobody knows John Quaid, a big actor, and in 1993 he did a bunch of seminars and he talked about everything that I talk about. He talked about the common law. He talked about being at law and not being, at grace and so forth. But you really need to watch it. It's about an hour-long seminar, okay? And the man clearly laid it out. We've known what the problem is. We've tried to write documents. We've tried to use the common law the way it is intended, and it doesn't work. They don't care. They aren't listening. They want to be in charge, and if you don't like it, they'll either lock you up, starve you out, or shoot you. This is the reality. What are you going to do about it? Or what are you preparing to do about it?
Well, I'm going to agree with you 100% on the following. Get ready for real change real fast. Even if Obama stays in, even if Romney's elected, the whole conversation is about to change, and it's about to get, I believe, Eric, we will see the boot heel of tyranny. We're already seeing it. Don't get me wrong. I mean, we're gonna hit a fiscal cliff. We're gonna see austerity here. We're gonna see people freaking out on one another. We're gonna see, like you said, NDAA 2013, more expansion of control, and it is going to be implemented on to the people of this country, like it or not, ready for it or not.
Well, you know, and here's the big thing. This is the reason, and we can talk about, oh, okay, you're gonna see this, you're gonna see that. This is the example. This is the reason why I'm talking about NDAA of 2013. It isn't even here yet. The new president isn't in office. It's not Red Party or Blue Party that is pushing this. It is a combination. It's already passed the House. Okay? It doesn't matter who's in the White House. These new rules, the increased tyrannical power in this new documentation, they're also in the new NDAA. With the stroke of a pen, they're doing away with restrictions on the government to pay using government taxpayer money to propagandize its own people. You really need to understand the next step that's coming, ladies and gentlemen, and you need to take a long, hard look at NDAA 2013, because it starts talking about the seizure of belligerent actors, terrorists. Exactly what me and Charlie have told you, okay? It addresses it. It funds an agency to be generated to start to deal with it. People, it's already on paper, and they're voting on it now. This is what's coming. So don't tell me it's a pipe dream. I've read it. They've told you what's coming.
And look, if you go to Google or any other search engine right now, type in NDAA 2013, Eric, I find this comical. And terrifying at the same time, but it's this. This is back in June, right? When they were putting this thing together, it's the same exact language as NDAA 2012 as far as the headlines go. Do you remember when NDAA 2012 was on the hook and Obama was going to veto it because it took away too many liberties, as he said, and then he went ahead and signed it and made a signing statement. Headline: Obama threatens to veto NDAA 2013. Too many restrictions on free speech. It's unbelievable. This same game, and Eric's 1,000% correct. However this shakes out tonight or in the next couple weeks, irrelevant. Irrelevant. Everything is already in place. If you listen to this program, or if you're just listening to us on Oracle, and you still believe that Romney's your guy because he's somehow business friendly and a conservative, you need to wake up, because he's the exact same individual as we have in there right now. It's irrelevant which one wins.
And his job when he gets into office is going to be to carry this, the mantra of the totalitarian state via legislation like the NDAA of 2013. He's just going to carry it forward. It doesn't matter which coat or which hat the individual is wearing when they get there. I mean, this is just so ridiculous to me, man. People are in such peril. Lives or families, communities are going to be torn apart. Everything. I mean, I really wish people understood, just looking at this video, watching the Gestapo soldiers, wandering around dealing with unarmed protesters with assault rifles.
Right.
Okay.
Right. And they look terrified. I thought one of them was going to pull a trigger. I really did. They look terrified of Occupy Denver protesters who had the courage to stand there and with a bullhorn in their face and say, "You're Nazis. You're nothing but terrorists." Eric Lovely, thank you very much for joining me on this Tuesday edition of Wide Awake News Radio. We'll get you back on Thursday.
Oh, absolutely, sir.
Yeah, you are, because I won't be here. You're going to be running the whole program. It's going to be Eric and Dex this Thursday, 5 o'clock West, 8 o'clock East. Eric Lovely, thank you very much. Guys, coming up next, we have Sherry Edwards. She's going to analyze some of the voice patterns of these would-be representatives. All right, we're going to be right back in just a few minutes. Hang tight.